Welcome to the non-religion specific rabbit that lays eggs holiday episode of Nerd Central. It has a shorter name, but by law and for the sake of comedy, we can't acknowledge that name. So let's lie to our kids and tell them there's a $100 bill in one of the eggs so they look harder and leave us alone. That way we can kick it to the news. Remember when DC and WB announced all those spin-off movies that we all deep down knew would never happen? Well, like 4 years later, it seems that WB has finally caught up to our wavelength, for they have just canceled the Trench and New Gods movie. How will we ever live without it? In Marvel news, recent images of toys for the upcoming Shang-Chi film confirms who the villain will be. We had our suspicions before, but now we can officially say the villain will be the Mandarin. Get that thing off the screen. That is not the Mandarin. We're getting the real Mandarin this time. Unless, of course, Marvel wants to take another awesome character and make him a joke. Again. Well, I suppose we should get to, hatching our next segments. I'm funny. Take it away, guys.
Hello and welcome back to B-Rated, the show that watches all of the movies everyone else is too scared to watch. As usual, I'm your host, Paige, and I think I've reached the point in this series where nothing surprises me anymore. What I mean by that is that I have stopped questioning why these movies exist and started questioning, when can I make time to watch them? I mean, this week's movie was watched a day and a half before this 3-minute segment was due. And given the fact that it usually takes me 10 to 15 hours to edit, we should probably get a move on. This week's Easter special is none other than Odessa Filmworks' Jesus Christ Vampire Hunter. So grab your candy and grab your wooden stakes because things are about to get interesting. The second coming is upon us, and Jesus has returned to Earth. But before he can get down to the serious business of judging the living and the dead, he has to contend with an army of vampires that can walk in the daylight. Combining kung fu action with the biblical prophecy and a liberal dose of humor, the film teams the savior with the Mexican wrestling hero El Santos against the mythological horrors. Viewers on Amazon Prime gave this movie a solid 4 out of 5 stars because apparently this movie has a little something for everyone. Well, everyone over the recommended viewing age of 16. Religious teachings? Check. Vampires? Check. Kung fu? Check. Big musical number? Check. A plot so unorthodox that it makes Killer Sofa look like Citizen Kane by comparison? Check. I honestly think that the best part of this movie was the writer's lack of restraint in this movie. They really said, it's 2003, we're gonna make this movie and we're not gonna care what anyone else says. Now give Jesus gauges and a buzz cut.
Please, help me.
Sorry, mate, my compassion ended at 6 p.m.
Okay, jokes aside, this movie has me questioning one of my core beliefs. I mean, I truly believed that this one thing, this motto, could get me through almost anything that life threw at me. But here I am questioning it. I mean, have I really been living a lie? Could it really be that you can't fix everything in post? I mean, I've seen actual editing miracles. What do you mean I can't fix everything in post? What am I supposed to do? Fix it beforehand? No way! I can do it! I can fix it in post. Watch me! Let this movie serve as a cautionary tale that some things need to be fixed in pre-production. There, I said it. Are you all happy now? In this movie's case, they really needed to make sure that the actors didn't sound stupid with the vampire teeth beforehand, because what they ended up doing to fix it was making a crappy dub in post-production.
I really wish we'd had the time to invite more people, Jesus. It's not every day a guy gets a chance to commit deicide. Sacrifice is your thing, isn't it?
I think you need to go back to Sunday school. My death was never the end of the story.
At least I assume that's why the vampires were dubbed over. No one else is. Overall, I have to applaud this movie for being so diverse and taking risks. If you dig deep enough, Jesus Christ Vampire Hunter actually had a pretty good moral to the story. And that moral is to love thy neighbor.
Learn to love. Learn to forgive. And remember, 5 keeps a neighborhood alive.
It's all good.
So when should you watch this movie? Only when you can't find your church's copy of The Passion of the Christ. And now it's time to spin the wheel of stupid cinema. Tune in next week when we watch The Jurassic Games. Thanks for watching.
Welcome back to Sideburns. I'm your lovable caveman host, Kyle, and this week's movie made me want to stick a D-cell battery to my tongue and jump in a pool. Please don't do that. That's right, the movie that never should have happened because it ruined the series for me and everybody else, it's The Last Airbender. Now if you haven't gathered, this show is about tearing movies apart. I'm not reviewing them, and this one is a doozy. So sit down, shut up, and strap in, because I'm bursting blood vessels this week. Alright, let's ruin my faith in humanity. The first thing I want to mention is the fact that Aang's arrow looks like a 4-year-old scribbled on his head with a crayon. It's not even close to the cartoon as we see here. Blue arrow. And this is a poorly done henna tattoo. Do you see the difference? I'd hope so, because Stevie Wonder can see the trash that this movie is. Speaking of seeing the bad, they did a terrible job at casting this movie. Okay, I get it. It's animated so the characters aren't real, but you could have at least found actors that look similar to their animated counterparts. I mean, look at this chart, for instance. Even Uncle Iroh, my favorite character, and they butchered it. If Iroh isn't your favorite character, I'm sorry, but you're wrong. But the worst is, okay, they actually casted the grandma relatively well, so kudos, I guess. But they didn't even get the proper facial hair right for characters who needed it. How hard is it to match facial hair and hairstyles? Here's a hint, it's not hard. And you mean to tell me they fed up the pronunciation of names? How? Okay, calm down, Kyle. Breathe, just like your therapist told you. Let me walk you through how they pronounce the names versus the way that the movie pronounced them. Starting with Aang, you say it like Aang, but the movie said Ung. What? Okay, that can't be that bad. Okay, next one, Sokka. Pretty easy, right? Wrong. They said Soka. But my boy Iroh, they couldn't possibly. What? Iroh, you pronounced it Iroh? What kind of illiterate person wrote this script? You had all the source material right in front of you and you didn't use it. And I'm not ignoring the fact that the special effects in this movie were absolute garbage, especially the firebenders. They produce the flame, which it should make it fuller and brighter, not just using the campfires that are around them. And the acting. My god, the acting. It was so forced, it made series seem laughably bad, like this one.
Okay, everybody can help us now!
I've lost all respect for people. The box office doubled the budget. The score is a 4 out of 10. How the hell do people enjoy this absolute fecal matter fest of a movie? Anyway, let's consult the dartboard of anger to find the next movie. That looks like the Ridiculous Six. Oh god. Oh, please, no. I'll see you guys in the next episode of Sideburns.
Thanks, bunnies. We're gonna hop on over to a break, but we have more stuff to show you, so stay tuned. Welcome back to Nerd Central. Hello. It's cute. Oh god. Oh, it's not opened. And with that, it's time for our next packs. Take it away, guys.
Okay, so I'll just come out and be honest. I finished watching the original series in 2018, meaning that some of the information I will share about Elijah and Haley might not be precise. However, please feel free to attack me for anything I say that's incorrect. Hey guys, welcome to another episode of Review Girl. I'm your host, Uhuman April Moltok, and today I'll be reviewing Elijah Michelson and Haley Marshall. This story, just like most of the others I've reviewed, is pretty twisted. Haley, a werewolf, and Klaus, who is Elijah's hybrid brother, have a one-night stand. We then discover that Haley is with child, and Elijah steps into the picture to convince Klaus that this baby could be the blessing that their 1,000-year-old family needs. The decision to allow the child to come into the world allows a weird but needed relationship to sprout between Haley and Elijah, as she navigates being pregnant with a part witch / werewolf / vampire. Elijah is there to take care of her and protect her from witches that want to harm the baby. When Hope is born, the witches attempt to sacrifice her life in order to strengthen their coven. They are killed mercilessly, and Hope is sent to stay with her aunt Rebecca. One would think that with Klaus and Hope out of the way, Elijah and Haley can finally settle down, But Haley shocks us all when she decides to marry Jackson to protect her pack and make them stronger. This relationship is a tragedy because when we finally think that everything is going well for them, something happens and everything goes south. The saddest part is that Haley dies trying to protect the family, and Elijah doesn't realize until much later when he wakes up from a sort of hex or spell he was put under. In the final season, he is left with her letters and memories to console himself, and I must say, even though falling in love with your younger brother's baby mama isn't the brightest of ideas, one must admit that when Cupid decides to aim, he shoots the butt cheeks regardless of what fate has in store. Originals is easily one of my top 5 series, and I recommend that you watch it, or if you're like me, you should definitely find time to watch it again. Well, that's it for today, guys. Tune in next week when I review Thomas and Grace by order of the Peaky Blinders.
Guess I'll see you in the next life.
If we're destined to meet each other in another life, just know I'll be waiting for another dance.
Hello, this is Drew, and welcome to Trash Flicks. This week, I'll be looking at the 2018 comedy Father of the Year. In this movie, two college kids debate about which of their dads would win in a fight, and this leads to a bunch of bizarre situations because one of the dads takes it a bit too seriously. First, let me go over what I somewhat, maybe, kinda, sorta liked about the movie. If I had to pick one thing that I at least tolerated with this movie, it was the acting, kind of. For most of the characters, it wasn't too bad. It was at least passable. I've seen worse. Another thing I kind of thought was interesting was the premise itself. Two dads in a fight to see who's better could be funny, but in this movie it wasn't. Now for the bad. This movie is awkward. I've watched movies before that are meant to be awkward, but this one just feels like they didn't quite know what they wanted to show. The pacing feels weird because the characters don't really have a main objective, so the big events and plot points don't flow too well. One moment, the main character's trying to build a pool, but in the other, he's helping his dad win an obstacle race, and the pool is completely forgotten for like a good 10-15 minutes. It's not even brought up. It just feels like they had a bunch of ideas and had a loose plot to thread it together. Another problem I had is the jokes. They aren't funny. At all. I found myself cringing, booming, and even yawning, doing just about everything I can do that isn't laughing. The comedy feels like it came from a group of middle school boys sitting around a lunch table. It's just gross out humor and sometimes offensive jokes with just bad punchlines. Most of the comedy, if you'd like to call it that, is laughing at the wimpy dad being wimpy. It's just super juvenile and doesn't work too well. Lastly, the whole premise is a bit strange. I touched on this when talking about the movie's plot. They do nothing really to progress the plot. First of all, the two students start everything because for some reason they're still doing the whole my dad would beat up your dad thing in college. It's obviously supposed to be seen as comedic, but since the jokes don't land, it just makes it look like they're weirdly obsessed with the combat abilities of their fathers. In the end, this movie's just an awkward, unfunny mess of a comedy that's full of gross-out humor, bad jokes, and juvenile comedy. While I like the idea it was going for, in execution, it just falls flat. This is Drew, and thanks for watching Trash Flicks.
What is up, you guys? Welcome back to a magical episode of Nerd Games. I'm your host, Emma, and this week I am testing my Ravenclaw prowess in a Harry Potter trivia game. Guest readers Kyle and Paige will be reading the questions off screen, and my guest and I will race to see who can answer the Harry Potter trivia first. For this game, I had to invite fellow Ravenclaw and Harry Potter expert, Corey.
Hey!
Which spell does Gilderoy Lockhart accidentally cast on himself in Harry Potter and the Chamber of Secrets? Is it Sectum Sempra? Sectum Sempra!
Sectum Sempra.
Sectum Sempra, Imperia, Expelliarmus, or Obliviate?
Obliviate.
Correct.
Good job.
Thank you.
What does SPEW stand for?
Society for the Promotion of Elvish Welfare.
It's not
correct.
Protection, it's promotion.
Correct. What is Dolores Umbridge's middle name?
What?
What is Dolores Umbridge's middle name?
No, yeah, I heard the question. I mean, answer. Yeah. I don't know.
There is Lynn, Jane, Sue, or Jean.
Oh, no.
Emma, you have picked up the tape. You must answer.
It's either Jane or Jean,
I think. Obviously Karen.
Definitely. Dolores Jane Umbridge. Dolores Jean Umbridge. Jane. Jean Umbridge. Jane Umbridge. Dolores Jean. Dolores Jane. I'm gonna go with Jane.
Emma says Jane.
And I hope I don't regret it.
You are correct.
That is correct.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, okay, cool.
What about Nearly Headless Nick's full name?
Sir Nicholas D. Mimsey Porpington.
You are correct!
I would kill for that full name. That is so cool.
Mimsey Porpington. I love that.
In the 19 years later epilogue, which is the eldest of Harry and Ginny Potter's kids?
Did you say Jamie Potter?
No, I said Ginny.
Gordon. Oh,
Ginny. It is James Sirius Potter.
That's correct.
James Sirius. Yeah.
James Sirius
Albus
is correct.
Albus Severus is the middle and Lily Luna is the youngest. Sirius.
What is the fluffy, best-selling pet available at Weasley's Wizard Wheezes?
Oh, I think I know it, but
would you guys like options?
Yes.
Wait. No. Pygmy Puff.
Emma would not like options.
She
has guessed a Pygmy Puff.
Pygmy
she
Puff.
Is correct?
Yeah. Yes! And the smartest Ravenclaw is me. Guess that means Corey's gonna get a healthy dose of pumpkin juice.
Oh, no.
Okay, you ready?
Yep.
3, 2, 1. Oh, that's cold! All right, that's it for this week. Tune in next week for another great episode of Nerd Games. Thanks, everyone. It's the day I've all been waiting for. I get to act like Wonder Woman after the break. Stay tuned.
Welcome to the Justice League Games! Now, I know you see the table before me and you're thinking, no, Cody, not this again. I thought you learned your lesson about waterboarding people. Relax, we're lassoing people. We're lassoing water bottles, because that's legaler. All right, but it's the Wonder Woman Challenge. We all loved Wonder Woman. You know that song. We don't need to pick teams today because we know who's competing. For Team Kyle, we have Paige Jennings. And for Team Emma, we have Krista Ott. Both women love Wonder Woman. And I'm excited to see how many of these bottles they can lasso. They will have 2 minutes to lasso as many as they can. And then, you know, just whoever either lassos all of them the quickest or gets the most within the time limit is gonna win. So let's see who our Wonder Woman is. You ready?
Yes.
3, 2, 1.
Yeah. No! They're knocking over!
Keep going!
Hold on!
Paige wrecked havoc in the studio.
I did
trying
havoc.
To get her first bottle.
But you know what? It'll be okay. I'm a cowboy, baby!
And Paige looking like Cowboy Craig as she attempts to her second bottle.
I must become a cowboy. Somehow, some way. Somehow,
Oh no, we don't like those.
I was 12! Can you believe?
1 minute left. And still no bottles. She keeps
that.
Knocking him over.
I know that.
Oh, she got one on the floor. Okay, her new strategy is just lasso one of the bottles that are on the floor and drag it towards her.
I'm knocking things over that aren't the water bottles, and I realized this strategy is not really working, and so I decided if I can't lasso it, I'm gonna fish it to me. And so I just throw it onto the thing and pull it. I'm like, yeah, this is working.
She keeps doing that. And she has one bottle. At a minute 30, she has one bottle. And she got two bottles.
Fishing, this is where my expertise is.
Okay, I think we found the answer to what to do is just knock them onto the floor and then roll them towards you with the lasso.
Krista shouldn't be allowed to watch this because she's going to steal my strategy.
And we have three bottles. And that's time. Three bottles for Paige.
You know, what's the worst that could happen? I lose? It's not like the expectations are very high. So, you know, I'm excited, I guess, but.
Krista, your time begins in 3, 2, 1. Krista has knocked very many of them off the table at this point. Just on her first attempt, she is going to continue trying. Oh, and she's going fishing. Oh, she gave up on fishing and is going back to, oh, and we're back to fishing. Krista has won. Chris is going back to the table. Oh, she has secured the edge. She has one in the loop. Will she be able to? Oh, very close, very close. All right, and we're on to fish. Fishing.
You got it, at least.
Yeah.
So I'm in the middle of this challenge, and I've already seen Paige do this challenge, and I feel bad about taking her fishing strategy. But here's the thing. Had I gone first, I wouldn't have done that because I would have thought it was cheating. But once I realized it wasn't cheating, then it's free game. And I got pretty close anyways, you know, like there's a few times I'm like, got it, but I didn't, but it was close. So I feel like had I like maybe had like, you know, 30 more minutes, I probably could have done it.
Paige. All right, we got 2 points. 1 minute left. All right, we're fishing and that's three points. All right, we're tied with Paige. You need to get one more within the next 40 seconds. Oh, she was very close to getting a perfect one on that one. 30 seconds left. She's still going out to the table, even though they're all knocked over. That'd be very difficult. And she's fishing again. 20 seconds. And she's got 4 points. Nope. 10 seconds left. And that's time. That's time. Krista won. And that's point number 2 for Emma's team.
Woo-hoo!
Yeah!
Well. I'm excited. I'm always excited when we get a point, which is rare, but I have been excited twice. So, and that's one more time than before, which is exciting. So I knew she could do it. I always knew she could do it. I'm so proud. We're doing so well, I say, as we have a 2-point deficit.
Mm-hmm.
Paige has failed you.
Yeah. I'm disappointed. I feel like I feel like my father, you know, 18 years ago. So I'm very disappointed. I thought she would, you know, be Cowboy Craig a little better, but she wasn't.
And that's going to do it for this week. I can't believe Emma's team actually got another point. It's great to see the 2-4 advantage. But we'll see you next time on the Justice League Games, only on Nerd Central, brought to you by KNWT.
Be very, very quiet. I'm hunting rabbits.
Oh, no. Why does it go that way? Okay.
Because it's coiled.
Yeah, why is it like that? Why is it hard?